Let's get to our guests around the crisis in Isfahan. You know, many of you who are listening around the world may know the desperate environmental crisis in Iran has been worsening for years now, but the situation, specifically the specter of water scarcity, has grown more dire this year. In July, we dedicated an episode of Rook to the water situation in the southern Khuzestan region of Iran and the protests that had emerged in the streets of many cities there. Now, a crisis really that has engulfed the whole country of Iran has become more pronounced in the central Iranian city of Isfahan, where farmers have taken to the streets in the thousands for the last fortnight. And then last Friday, during a massive demonstration, hundreds of those making their voices heard were arrested in violent protests over the drying up of a lifeblood river. There are disturbing reports about horrific injuries sustained by protesters, intimidation of medical staff in hospitals attending to the wounded. The protests were initiated by farmers demanding their water rights after a blockage of the Zayandarud River by state water authorities. In order to give us a perspective on this crisis, I'm joined by two Iranian observers who've been following the events closely. Alan Ekbatani is a geotechnical engineer based in California. Before migrating to the United States, he worked as a private sector geological surveyor and led the pre-construction survey teams on many dam projects in Iran. Alan is joining us from Irvine, California. Hello, sir.
Hello, and thank you for having me.
Thank you very much for being on the program. And Mohammad Manazarpour is a veteran journalist who is based in Washington, D.C. He was a longtime bureau chief for the BBC Persian Service, BBC Persian's first Middle East correspondent, in fact, as well as later being the executive editor of VOA Persian. Mohammad is now the general manager of Persis Media and director of Persis News Agency. He is also a contributing editor with Rook Media. And Mohammad Manazarpour joins us from Washington, D.C. today. Hello, Mohammad.
Hello, Jian. It's a pleasure to be with you.
Thank you. It's always good to talk to you, Mohammad. Let me start with you. There was a violent crackdown on protesters in the central Iranian city of Isfahan, as I said, last week, after the Iranian government seemed to be tolerating growing protests over scarce water supplies over the previous 2 weeks. What happened on Friday?
On Friday, the regime forces attacked the protesters. They began the attack in the middle of the night. That they set fire to the camps erected by the protesting farmers, and they basically attacked them with the special anti-demonstration police and also with their plainclothes suppressive kind of gangs, or the Basij, the IRGC mobilization force. And the farmers returned to the dried riverbeds the subsequent day. There were further attacks. They shot a lot of the protesters with pellet guns. And we're seeing horrific injuries sustained by the protesters on their faces. Many people have lost their sights because of the pellets, which have directly hit the eyes of some protesters. Right now, as we speak, Isfahan is under pretty much a siege by the anti-demonstration police, and the gathering has been disrupted, but there is a kind of state of emergency in Isfahan.
You mentioned where the farmers were protesting. I just want to put a fine point on this for those who haven't seen the video footage, because it's quite astounding to see. The farmers were actually gathering in the thousands where the river had been. I mean, as if to really make the point of it, where the demonstration was happening was where water used to be, right?
Exactly. Isfahan, as you know, was the capital of Iran for many, many years, and the location of the city is strategically based on the Zayandarud River, which literally means the birth-giving, the life-giving river. And many Isfahani farmers depend on the water distribution by the river for their agricultural farms, and they've lost their livelihoods over the recent years, where the water has become more scarce by the year. And now it's dry for the better half of the year.
Alan, let me bring you in here. In a moment, I want to ask you about what the reasons are why this environmental situation has arisen in Iran. But first, just tell me about how you see the nature of how this is expanding and extending. In July, there were widespread protests in Khuzestan, in the Khuzestan region, which has been, of course, hit hard by water shortages. Isfahan now is Iran's third largest city. What does it mean from your perspective that mass protests on the environmental situation in Iran have now extended to Isfahan as the new epicenter?
Short answer to your question is absolutely mismanagement of the government. We have been living in this semi-arid area for centuries, depending on the population and local needs. We had managed how to distribute the water by a man who is named in Persian Mirab, both in local and national scale. To do this, in the modern history, the first project to develop an area or a country is the land use planning, to get to know about the potentials of each area, either mining, industry, agriculture, and so on. The water resource is the main issue for all of these prospective models to focus on.
So I take it you're not surprised that this is now hitting Isfahan hard and that there's been protests there?
No.
Can I just ask you on the, I mean, what do you make of the what the government says? I mean, the Iran Meteorological Organization estimates that some 97% of the country is dealing with drought at some level, that this is the drought situation is worse than it's been for many, many decades. How much is drought to blame for the water shortages, as the government claims? And how do you balance the environmental reasons for this, like drought, like God-given events, versus mismanagement?
Actually, the government duty is to predict any events that will be coming on in the future, like drought, like hurricane, like everything. Of course, drought is a problem in the semi-arid area we live in, but drought is not the main problem. The main problem is mismanagement and not predicting about the drought, the distributing of water system. For example, we cannot make a steel plant in a desert as Islamic Republic did. Land use planning, unfortunately, land use planning project never has been planned in Iran. Neither Pahlavi regime nor Islamic Republic tried to do this. That is the main reason for this mismanagement.
Sorry, why would they? I know we're supposed to not be surprised by strange, if not moronic, decisions that the government of Iran sometimes makes, but why would they do that? Why would they build steel plants in the middle of a desert that would require the diversion of water resources?
There is a lot of reasons. There is a lot of reasons. For example, a man in the government is from Kerman. He likes to make a steel plant in Kerman. He didn't think about that, if this area can accept this plant or not. The other thing is the corruption. Corruption, corruption. The government, Islamic Republic government, is a corrupt government. And they do everything about their benefits, not about the national benefits. Local benefits, personal benefits, always is the first reason, not national benefits.
Mohammed, as Alan is suggesting this, and when we had Kaveh Madani on a few months ago about the same crisis, this isn't brand new. This mismanagement has been going on for years. This is an accumulation of events. This key river for Isfahan, this major Zayanderud River, has faced water shortages and droughts for years. And I know farmers have intermittently protested the lack of attention given to this issue for a long time. Why has the volume been turned up now? Why the last couple of weeks?
I think there are a number of reasons. One is that many farmers have been sustaining their livelihood by selling what little they have, selling parts of their land, selling their machinery, selling their tractors. And they've always been promised an elevation of water rights in multiple years, and that has never materialized. At the same time, Iran is faced with massive inflation, and right now, many of these farmers honestly cannot make ends meet. They cannot continue to sustain their families, their lives, by just selling whatever they've had. There is nothing more to sell. And there is no water coming either. So they are basically at the end of their patience. There is no hope for them. And that's why they have resorted to this kind of very peaceful protests, I must say. The protests were very peaceful before the regime decided to crash down on them and suppress them and uproot the protests.
Alan, you're not just an observer sitting in California. I mean, you have firsthand experience with this situation in Iran. You were there. You've been the lead assessor on many dam projects in Iran, including the what has been described as the catastrophic Godvand Dam on the River Karun. You advised against the construction of that dam in particular. Can you give us specifically in that case why you were against it and why your words were not accepted or heeded by the government?
Actually, in Godvand area, I was a consultant engineer in geotechnical project in both pre-feasibility and feasibility phase of the Godvand project. And we worked more than 2 years, day and night, 24 hours, 7 days per week. Finally, we chose 5 axes for the dam. The axis number 5 was the worst one because of Gatsaran formation behind the axis and in reservoir too. I wrote in my report clearly and transparently, this axis number 5 is not a good point for this dam.
Sorry, let me just cut you off there for those of us who are not engineers or geological experts. What is an axis point for a dam? What is that?
The point dam should be built at is the axis of the dam.
Okay.
And behind the axis was the Gatsara formation, full of salt, and the material can be solved with the water, and in the reservoir too. But they didn't listen to us. I did argue with them. Why did you pay money to us? And we had been working 2 years here, day and night, to get a good result, to know what place is good. And now we are telling you that this place is not good. Why do you want to build that one? But they didn't listen to us. This is a sign of mismanagement. Of course, there was a corruption, financial corruption behind that. This is a long story about the corruption of that project that made it disastrous in our country.
So in a sense, so you're saying you could have basically predicted a lot of what you and other experts like yourself who were actually working on this stuff could have predicted that this was all going to happen.
Clearly, I have written in my report that the Gatsaran makes a lot of problem with the water and in the structural damage for the dams too, because of the solving the Gatsaran formation, make the heavy formation above that could be filled in the dam, and the dam will be destroyed.
When you say that they didn't listen to you, your immediate superiors or the people in the environment ministry or in charge of water, I get it. There's corruption. There's mismanagement. Why wouldn't they have the foresight to realize that if the country is starving, if there's a water scarcity crisis, it's going to affect their popularity or their interests as well, is it not?
At that time, there was an election period for Rafsanjani. It was the last period of time, and they want to tell the people and to the government that we made a lot of projects, we made a lot of dams, no matter what kind of dams, just showing off, and financial corruption too. After our report, the head of this project changed the supervisors because they followed our report. They changed all of that and brought a new managers.
It must be heartbreaking for you, Alan, to...
Not for me, for the nation.
For you to see what's happening in Iran, given
my
that...
My team was about 300 people. 300 people, engineer, doctorate, workers, technician, worked 2 years, day and night, 24/7. And finally, they didn't listen to us and made this disastrous for the nation. Of course, it is heartbreaking for me. But what can I do? Opportunity, there is not any short-term remedy.
Let me get to remedies. But I just want to bring Mohammed in. As you've been listening to Alan talk about this, I'm guessing that, first of all, that none of what he's saying is entirely a surprise to you, but that also what happened with the Gudvand Dam is not an anomalous situation, but something you've heard over and over again. Can you speak to this?
Yes, absolutely. Unfortunately, most of the dams which were constructed and the dam construction project began during Ayatollah Rafsanjani's presidency. He was kind of portraying himself as the director of reconstruction of the country. But most of these projects later proved to be based on very short-term, short-sighted political gains. The people who were in power, they prioritized their regional alliances over national interests. And many such dams basically destroyed the natural flow of water across the country. And the downstream areas were devastated by the construction of these dams. None of the dams that were constructed after the revolution have had any constructive role in the distribution of water or in the production of hydroelectric power in the country.
Well, it sounds like it's not just they didn't have a constructive role. It sounds like they made things worse.
Absolutely, absolutely. Because they were done for regional, they wanted to solidify their base, their regional kind of support base, their grassroots supports in the areas that they originated from. And this devastated the water distribution in the country, which we are now faced with. And as Mr. Ekbatani said, basically there are no short-term remedies now. It's not possible for the regime to open some of these dams. For example, the Gotvan Dam, if it's opened, if the water reservoir is opened, the highly salty water would destroy the agricultural fields downstream. Right. Right. They don't know what to do with it now. That's the reason. And water is being diverted for many pet projects by the IRGC, financial institutions, organizations and companies which are connected to the Revolutionary Guards. They have constructed all sorts of crazy projects in desert areas, like ceramic companies and whatnot, heavily dependent on water. I really don't see a solution for the regime to come out of this crisis.
The country is also interconnected. So, I mean, in the summer, we were talking about Khuzestan and a couple of other regions, Balochistan, but now Isfahan. I mean, would you presume that this is just going to keep happening all over the country? Or, I mean, if we're not seeing protests in Tehran because it hasn't hit home there yet, but it will at some point.
Absolutely, absolutely. The water crisis is going to just grow because there are no immediate solutions. There is no button that they can press to elevate the water shortage in the country.
Okay.
So it's just going to spread across the nation.
So Alan, let me bring you back in here because, I remember the same feeling speaking to Kaveh Madani a couple of months ago, because the only thing more devastating than hearing about the water crisis that's currently occupying Iran in such a devastating way is to hear that there's no way to fix it. It is so embedded in problems now that a solution is years away somehow. So if you were If you did have the ear of the government, if they brought you back right now and said, we will listen to you, tell us what to do, what would you say, Alan? How would you try to begin to fix this?
Unfortunately, there is not any short-term remedy for this. No, there is not short-term remedy. But there is a long-term or at least a middle-term remedy for this crisis. If there is a big if here, if we are ready to a big surgery in our developing system, not only in water resources, for everything, because they are connected together. Water resources, industries, mining, agriculture, all is connected to each other. So we have to have a big surgery in our developing system. Is Islamic Republic ready for this? The answer is no. So the crisis will be rising up. I'm sure that the crisis will be rising up.
Does Iran have the resources for a big surgery, as you say?
If the government wants, yes. There is a remedy for big surgery, but Islamic Republic is not ready for that.
All right. Mohammed, let me finish off with asking about the protests on Friday and what they represent. I mean, the government, of course, blamed the protests on anti-revolutionary elements and blamed the violence in Isfahan on anti-revolutionary elements. The protests, I guess you could say, turned political in Isfahan. There were chants of death to the dictator. That sentiment seems more widespread and more publicly expressed than, say, a decade or two ago. Maybe there's more oxygen for that kind of sentiment. Have the protests gotten bolder and more vociferous in your view?
I think that is an accurate description. Basically, because of the immense economical crisis that the country is grappling with, the majority of the middle class are now under the poverty line. And the national currency, the riyal, is losing value at an astronomical rate. That is why many people are now openly calling for regime change in Iran. This wasn't the case a couple of years ago. I mean, this is not the first protest that we've had, but what we are seeing in recent protests is people calling for regime change. And that is something which is new on the Iranian political spectrum. I think it's an issue which is going to become stronger by the day, because the structure of the government is, and the ideology of the government is, the main reason for the shrinkage in the purchase power of the average Iranian family. Iranians are now suffering because of the government's international policies, because of the regime's hold on the economy. More than 80% of the economy is now controlled either by the state or by organizations which are very closely affiliated to the state. The private sector is basically disseminated and destroyed, and people are losing their livelihoods. That's the main reason. There are many, many Iranians who have no prospects of finding a job despite having the right education, despite having the training. There are no jobs to be created because there is no investment in the private sector. And I don't see any way for the regime to come out of this mess unless they totally change their ideology.
The big surgery that Alan's talking about.
Exactly.
Mohammed, I thank you very much for this. Alan, thank you so much today.
Thank you very much for having me on, and it's always a pleasure.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for having me.
I hope we have a chance to have you both on again and at some point for something more positive than this kind of news. Thank you to both of you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.